our life, we will face with many evils, many dark forces. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against powers and principalities. The good news is, these great men and women of God, in their lives, they fought a good fight, a fight that was already over, but were able to enter into the victory and blessing that Jesus has already purchased for us on the cross. John Payton had to fight against white slave traders who were doing this horrible thing of taking black people as slaves and giving guns into the hands of cannibals. The work of evangelism is a fight against the forces of darkness. The good news is the battle is won, the victory is won. You and I have to move in and enjoy the blessings and benefits of the victory that Jesus has done for us on the cross. John Payton did. Let's listen to his story.
The lives of missionaries always challenges me. Several of them bid goodbye to their beloved families and friends, leave their comfort zones and take the good news of Christ to those in great need, often facing danger to their own lives. Now we shall briefly study the life of John Payton, missionary to the New Hebrides. He was born on May 24, 1824 in Scotland. His father was a businessman, but a godly man who prayed earnestly thrice every day for his family, country, and the world. His mother too was a godly lady. Once when the father was away and the children were hungry and had nothing to eat, she made them pray to God and sent them to bed, assuring them that God, who had heard their prayer, would provide them food in the morning. Sure enough, God sent them food in the morning. The mother taught them that God would always give what was good for them and what brought glory to himself. John Payton joined his father in his business when he was just 12. He learned how to use several tools. This knowledge helped him greatly during his missionary service. Payton studied medicine and theology in Glasgow. At the same time, he worked as a teacher just to support himself. As a young man, he joined the Glasgow City Mission, where he labored fruitfully among drunkards and others in need for 10 years. John Payton was burdened to go to the New Hebrides, a chain of 80 islands in the South Pacific Ocean, northeast of Australia, now called Vanuatu. Cannibals who ate human flesh lived there. Missionaries who had gone there before him were killed and eaten or were sent away. In 1852, two more missionaries were sent to one of the islands called Anithyam, where they reaped abundant fruit. By 1872, everyone in that island became Christians. In 1858, John Payton sailed to the island called Tana with his wife Mary. In March 1858, both his wife and newborn son died. He was grief-stricken. He himself buried them both close to his house. He too was attacked 14 times by fever and ague. Yet Payton never gave up. He labored alone. There was only one old native convert called Abraham to assist him. Many a time his house was surrounded by the natives who came with weapons to shoot him. Some of the guns the natives used were given by white traders in exchange for slaves. At other times, when he went out, the natives were hiding, ready to attack him. Thus, he spent 4 years in Tana. His labor seemed fruitless. The next 4 years were spent in mobilization in Australia and Great Britain. Several missionaries were sent to the New Hebrides as a result. Even little children brought gifts which helped him procure a ship which they named Day Spring. John Peyton married Margaret in 1864. In 1866, they returned to the New Hebrides, but this time it was the island called Aniwa. God blessed their labor together for 41 years. He learned the language through signs and reduced it to writing. He then translated the New Testament into the Aniwan language. Margaret Peyton taught skills such as sewing, hat making to the women there. They taught them to wear clothes. There was scarcity of water in Aniwa. After prayer, Peyton started digging a well, promising them that Jehovah would provide water. The natives could not simply understand how the earth could produce rain. When finally they tasted the water, after much fear and apprehension, they believed in Peyton's God, and the whole island turned to God. It is heartening to see that their son went to Tana to evangelize that island. John Peyton was a man of great courage. This courage had its roots in his godly parents, godly upbringing, influence of a godly church, his own strong faith in God's sovereignty, and the constant presence of his Almighty God. What a beautiful life he lived. He died in 1907. Today, 91% of the people in the islands are Christians. Is it not marvelous?
There are two things in the lives of some of these great men and women of God, these missionaries. Number one is whatever sacrifice they did, whatever sufferings they went through. The second aspect is that their accomplishments, their achievements. When you put both of them in a balance, their achievements are so great. Whatever sufferings or inconveniences or whatever they laid down for the sake of the gospel is nothing in comparison to what they have achieved in their lives. Whatever John Peyton achieved was so great that he rewrote the history of those tribes in the islands near Australia. You and I have a life to live. Let's live it. Let's achieve great things and rewrite human history. It was said about the apostles that these are the men who turned the world upside down. You and I are called for that ministry. Praise God for these men and women. As we read and meditate and listen of the lives of these great men and women of God, may we also rise up and do these things and even greater things. God bless you.